so Jason Plotz, he's Professor of Economics here at MIT, in fact in the Spirit Building is where magic happens, so to speak. He's also adjunct associate professor at UQ and adjunct scholar, or adjunct fellow at the Institute of Public Affairs. So his work in general is basically about ideas and economic growth and how those two stitch together. He's very engaging and infectious speaker, particularly when he's speaking on classical liberalism. So
I'm just speaking on the subject.
That's it.
By the way, one of our subjects in this tool is...
All right, sorry about that.
Yes.
And you can see the subjects and have less contact hours.
All right, so the what I'm going to do is I was given instructions to talk for about an hour about classical librarianism and introduce this as some of you will have done nothing but read everything about this for the last 22 years and others of you will be relatively fresh to it. I wouldn't mind a little bit of insight as to who has been obsessed about this for say less than 5 years. Alright, so, kind of that way. What I'm going to do is I'm going to present an idea, I mean, this is kind of my view of what classical liberalism is, which I have this classical liberalism, libertarianism, fight between the two. I want to ignore that for the moment, pretend that it's all one big sort of happy family. Later on we can pick it apart and you can get you into Trotsky's groups and your otherwise. But I want to treat this as a sort of single idea, discuss what it is, discuss why I think your initial ideas about it are probably a little bit wrong. I want to correct those insights. And then I want to do the economics professor thing where I go, and what it really means is actually it's about economics. But, so this will be a high. But the preface here is a little bit of a lecture. This will work best if we have it interactive as we go along. The lecture will be as short or as long as it needs to be. It doesn't really matter if we're only to the second slide, even though there's about 30 of them. But rather than waiting until we get to the end. So any questions as we go along, take that. So we'll start with what we all can agree on. So classical liberalism / libertarianism, ignore the difference for now. Is basically, first and foremost, a political philosophy. Okay. Now, some of you may know it as a natural law principle, others may recognize it as the right and true basis of economics, others may see it as a moral philosophy. I want to just sort of again go, well, yes, it's kind of all those things, but first and foremost, it's actually a political philosophy. That's where it came from. It's got a number of different origins that all come together. If you're a good historian, you'll know that it actually goes back to the Spanish Solomon periods, to all the Chinese sea. We can carve it this way and that way and find origins that go back hundreds and hundreds of years in history. But the origin I'm going to trace it from is its kind of secular origin, which is more or less the Scottish Revolution associated with Adam Smith and Keynes and David Hume and the like. The basic idea as a political philosophy is, again, ideas that you're well familiar with, ISU, discussed in detail, ISU. Basic principles of civil liberties. Basic principles of rule of law. This is the more sort of modern idea that gets discussed, and we'll meet this one again and again. The practical expression of that is limited government. Limited government doesn't just mean small government, it means a check on executive power. Like the check on executive power for the previous two reasons. It's the check on executive power is how you get to rule of law and civil liberties. There's property rights, and what's property rights got to do with that? We'll discuss that as we go. There's a natural law principle there. There's a whole lot of sort of philosophical arguments about why property rights. There's also quite instrumental economic arguments about why property rights. Property rights are kind of a fundamental thing, but again, I want to get to why that is. Free speech is in there as well, and people, that's a good thing in principle, but it's also an instrumental instrumental properties that are there. And then there's a type of economics associated with this. Any just obvious disagreement with this? Can we agree on this principle? Political philosophy, first and foremost. Understand that it's a broad concept. Yes.
I don't have a disagreement. I was curious, what the heck is natural law? Is it not something to do with animals?
Natural law is pretty much the idea that we can derive principles of justice from first principles, and that these things are, in an essence, were axiomatic. The natural law is effectively to be contrasted with the idea that there is an executive branch of people, and they will decide what law is for us. So it's kind of like the, the way I understand it is it's kind of like the Protestant Reformation. Right? You've either got, there's a sacred book that only these people can read, and they'll tell you what it is, or we can all study the book and figure out what it means for us. So natural law is essentially this idea that through reason we can arrive at principles of the principles that would govern a society. This is Roman philosophy. So I'll park that on for the moment. The point I'm trying to make here is that it's not just one thing. It's not obviously a moral thing. It's not obviously a political thing. It's not obviously a philosophical thing. It's not obviously an economic thing. It's kind of all of these things together. I want that to be a starting point, because a lot of the debates that we have within why is libertarianism different, classical liberalism different from etc. etc. are really arguments about, well, this is really a moral foundation. This is really about politics. This is really about it. I just want to start by putting them all into a box, throwing them up and going, well, okay. Alright, what do we do with that? As I said, if we get into exegesis, we can trace origins way back. The secular understanding of this, in the sense of the great books that everyone's expected to read, more or less associate with these names. What we'll notice about them is they're all dead, they're all white, they're all male, some of them are French. can't help that. So this is a European movement, in essence. It then got transported to America by one of the greatest Frenchmen ever to live, who then pointed out to the Americans that they could also be awesome in French if they... some of the French people in French were recognizing these problems with their own societies. But the reason that it is this sort of dead white European male thing is that just there were a bunch of political revolutions going on in the home of these dead white males. And what was essentially going on was these were the people that were trying to understand what was going on and calling it out, going, that looks really, really like it's going to end badly. Pointing to things that looked at the time like, hooray, why would an enormous powerful king who is awesome be a bad thing? If you have an awesome king, nothing can go wrong. A bad king can be awful, but... And these people were effectively going, nah, good king, bad king, you've got a deeper problem here. They're all more or less making the same point at different points in time to different people. What we also find, just when you've run through them, is that I said a political philosophy, and you see I even use the bold highlight to say political philosophy, right? Every single one of these people identify themselves as political philosophers, but those of you who have read more deeply recognize some of those are economists. It's true, a lot of them were, or are what we now call economists. They wouldn't have seen that at the time. They would say, oh, I'm a political philosopher who writes about economics. So I'm a political philosopher who writes about epistemics. They didn't make the distinctions that we make now between all these different ways of doing. So when the throw those ones out, there was a whole bunch of sort of Frenchies and Englishmen and Scottishmen. What was going on there was there were basically three revolutions. There was an English Revolution, Scottish Revolution and the French Revolution, and pretty much all of these people were writing in response to those things. It was that was the context. This wasn't sitting alone in an office just going up.
Okay, my history, it was
the modern versions of events around the
Wow, this is, I mean, the these sorts of things, again, you would have seen them. What we'll notice again is that, yeah, they're economists, and it's like, well, you know, yeah, Hayek wasn't actually, you know, really in Nobel Prize for Economics, working on School of Economics, Chicago School of Social Thought, but was really a political philosopher, or a legal scholar, who was much more like this lot. Same thing about my workshop, political philosophy. Milton Friedman, an economist, but read more deeply into him. He was very much a kind of day-to-day type person. In Australia, we associated this with the Centre of Independent Studies, the Institute of Public Affairs. These are think tanks that are more or less in this space, basically them and more or less nothing else. The surprising thing is among economists, this is actually a relatively minority position, which I feel humiliated for my profession that is the case, but there really are only a handful of schools around the world that I'd self-identify and absolutely identify as classical liberal or libertarian in spirit, which means there's at least three people in the department, say 50. That's what it takes. It's homeopathic doses. So Chicago, old Chicago, is what I really mean there. These days, not so much. The center of the world is George Mason University in Fairfax County, just outside of Washington. If you're ever anywhere on that east coast of the US, pay a visit to walk up and down the hallways and continue for that. In Australia, I mean, the reason we're sort of so keen to host this conference here is that this RMIT University is pretty much where all of the classical liberal economists are. Look, we're still trying to get the rest of them down here. We know who they are, but you know, we read that email today, right now, not today. So there's one, two at Griffith, you may know them. There were some in Q. Melbourne's pretty derelict. ANU is just an embarrassment. Sydney has always been novel. There's a reason that you want them all in one place. These work as a school of thought. They need each other for support, otherwise, it's just loneliness. Most of the bits of interesting work is really done through postgrads and postdocs and the like. So that's what we're sort of in the process of building up here. It started with Sinclair Davidson, some of you may know. He can't be here today because he's in America, telling the Americans. But he would be here if he was. So that's kind of the who. Let's deal with this right now because everyone is their favorite thing. Libertarians and classical liberals are not left and they're not right. They're like both. They're the freedom aspects of both. So we just want to make sure that we're all on the same page. This, if anyone wants to fight about this, now's the time. Otherwise, this one pass. I want to turn this up deliberately. I want to just notice some of the things. The classical liberals and libertarians have kind of the same amount of problems with the right as they do with the left, but for different reasons. And it's kind of the same thing in each case. It's stop being totalitarian about that. Stop being. It's just different that, basically. So you can see in the middle of personal freedom, economic freedoms, freedom. So that's, again, this is a nice and easy way to recognize this. So my point. What then? So we've got lots of ideas, revolutions, dead white 18th century males, left, right. What is the one thing it's all about? One word.
Freedoms.
Yeah, you saw it right there. Freedom. That's I'm assuming that that's your implicit starting axiom, right? That what we are really about, we agree with, and what they don't agree with. They're anti-freedom and they're for freedom. You know, the Iran's flag, this is the original American flag. Freedom. What I want to suggest, and this is my sort of the purpose of this talk, is to suggest that this isn't the right answer. And I appreciate that it just sounds like that's immediately wrong right from the start, but it says it right there. Okay? What do we want to do? Now, the point I'm going to make is that this, what are we about, answer freedom. What are we about? Freedom everywhere. What's the reason that we want that? Small government? Freedom. What's the reason we want that? Freedom. That's the, when you get to the word freedom, you can stop thinking. That's the bit. What I want to suggest is that this is the bit that appeals to people who are under 35. Just pick a number that's less than whatever. You know. This is the one. This is the entry point into classical liberalism and libertarianism, as it's about freedom. And yeah, I mean, it makes a lot of sense with that. And this is what I want to get to. The reason that freedom as a foundation makes sense is that it makes sense from an individualist perspective. And that's pretty much the philosophy that goes along classical liberalism and libertarianism, is it's against group philosophies. It absolutely is. It's right from the beginning, it's about freedom for the individual. Freedom for me, freedom for you. And all of this sort of reason that we value limited government, this is a way of enabling my freedom. Effectively stopping you from approaching the meeting. So we end up with a notion that is that we have freedom and individualism together. Those of you who have actually met other people and discussed these ideas with them will know that you can be quite in a certain sense that, well, you know, you just really don't care about, you know, everyone else. That's down to sort of just the problems with individualism. As well, that's not really a very warm and cuddly philosophy. It doesn't really make you look like a nice person. It makes you just more or less look like a fellow filling in the place. What I want to suggest is that they're not wrong about this. And when we frame the answer to what is classical liberalism, what is libertarianism about, and then go freedom, and then go, well, what are we then doing? We're against things that take away our freedom. We're possibly missing the point. And so I want to present this as this is my view of where classical liberalism goes. I've been in this space for 20 odd years, and my thinking on this has shifted more in this direction. I want to present this to you. I expect you to probably disagree with this mostly, but I'm going to spend the rest of the hour so just really presenting Facebook why I think freedom isn't the foundation. I don't know what the foundation is, it's self-organization or emergence. And freedom is actually a mechanism by which you get this thing. So that's where I'm going to go with this. And I want to frame this in the sense of, if you say freedom is the foundation, then what you're against is things that restrict freedom. So that's why free speech is how you protect freedom. This is why property rights, that you protect people taking stuff. Positive way to look at this is freedom works because it sits on this notion that it's an individually justified philosophy. And it is. You can build an ethics around it, you can build a philosophical principles around it, you can build morals around it, you can build methodological individualism and economics around it, you can build a whole lot of stuff on that. But where you then run into arguments with people and they go, but you don't care about society. You go, well, what is this thing you call society? I want to try and pick that up. So, what I'm going to present now is the classical liberalism angle. Classical liberalism is the libertarian view of the foundation that's about society. And what do you think? Are we for? we're reframing this not as freedom, not as individuals, but as classical liberalism for society, what shifts? The clearest view on this is by Mike Munger, who has the awesomest hair. This is the best. I am the best. Do you know Mike? this is a name you've all seen. Anyone? If you haven't seen him before, Michael Munger is a professor of political philosophy at Duke University in the US. He ran for the US Senate as a libertarian candidate. He does it every time, loses every time, but just has awesome speeches. This is from a little op-ed piece he did in the Freeman a few years back, where he answers this question. What are libertarians for? If we're, and I love this answer. I think it's exactly the right answer. We're not looking for freedom. What we are for is voluntary action. That's what we fight for. Freedom is one of the mechanisms we use to get there. But what we are for is about the ability to construct our own societies, to not impede other people from constructing their societies, to not have societies foisted upon us. But when we're doing the libertarian thing, freedom isn't the end goal. The end goal is a society that we want, we choose to be, as opposed to being forced into one. And I love that. I think that's one that we can then go out there and have reasonable conversations with people that disagree about us, about where are poor societies. We're trying to build better societies. That's the foundations of libertarianism and classical liberalism. Not about that they do not meet this bedrock of individual freedom, where you can just, if you don't want to wear pants, you're not going to wear pants, whatever. It's not that. I mean, it's fine, but it's not what we're for. What we're for is for society, for the ability to create and build through voluntary action. The types of communities that we want. Communities, what are communities? Communities are ways in which we do stuff. The ways we organize knowledge, the ways in which we achieve particular things voluntarily, out of the voluntary associations. And I love that, because right there you've got the, and that's why we're not so much with the totalitarianism, centralized power. We don't like that, not just because it's that, but because it gets in the way of this. The more there is of that, the less there is of this. So that's kind of my argument that I want to now go through and look at this then from the economic perspective. Because the basic economic line, why do we like free markets? Why are free markets and libertarianism and classical liberalism together? It's not because these free markets are awesome. They're not. They're actually quite messy and expensive. I mean, there's a whole lot of issues we can discuss about what's wrong. Well, they are awesome. The reason we like, that they enable voluntary associations, contracts, to come to work. They enable firms to come together with their contracts. They enable these voluntary associations, things we call firms, organizations, and so on, to form exactly in ways that that people will think work, and to fall apart when they don't work. That's why we like markets. It's not because they're efficient. They're not. Really, it's this one. All right, so winding back, let me retell this story again. What was going on with those dead white males during these revolutions is that this was always their point. They weren't jumping up and waving flags and shouting freedom. What they were discussing, and this was never more clear than Alexis de Tocqueville's work, was that they were discussing the ability, the virtue of a self-organizing society. Right? If you go back and look through Smith, through Hume, through Mill, that was their thing. Was the type of institutions and mechanisms and laws that would enable a society to self-organize without central control. That was always the point. That's the thing that sits at the core of classical liberalism. The idea of a society forming without a center, without someone being in control and designing. Now, we can think of that as a statement about freedom and individualism, and it is, because that's what we get from that. But that wasn't the target. The target was, what does a world look like without kings? And what they were fighting against, what the whole reason for putting together this vast philosophical movement is, was the idea that a society without kings could actually exist and be in order. And what I want to suggest, there's a rediscovery of the powers of man. We saw this recognition that the trade was a virtue and not usury and so on. We saw the end of the sort of nobility and just the institutions of kings and landholders and serfs and vassals and all of those sort of European ways of saying slavery. We saw the pushback against the totalitarian forces. Now, all of those were reactions against. The big new idea, the idea that the classical liberals discovered, the idea that later was picked up by Sir Charles Darwin and others, it's like, oh, that might apply elsewhere. Their main thing that they did as an intellectual contribution was this last bit here. That's what we owe them. And this is the foundation of classical liberalism and libertarianism. It's not freedom, it's spontaneous order. It's the discovery that, left to their own devices, in a system that had this is what rule of law means, is that we've got a set of rules, and it doesn't matter who you are, they apply to everyone. There's no sort of, except for you, you can override. There's none of that. There's none of this sort of system of rules, simple rules, and within that, in the absence of kings, in the absence of great leaders, in the absence of men of vision and power, that just people figuring stuff out, subject to these rules, would produce an orderly society. That was the first time in 100,000 years that idea had really taken off. And it was Adam Smith, it was David Hume, it was Lord Keynes that first explained that. That was the shock that the intellectuals were shocked with the new at the time. It was that they were presented and they were saying, we theorize here, we walk off and all of the language, that a society like this will be ordered. It will not be chaotic. That was the big new idea. That was the foundation of classical liberalism. That was what they were fighting. Against them were rising up the forces, and this is like Rousseau and all of the other apologists for the ones that wanted to topple the kings and then replace them with different leaders. They wanted, not kings, kings are awful. We want kings in suits. We want ones that will have democracy and they'll have, control and whatever. But they had the same idea of, without someone leading and planning a society, there will be chaos. Right? So that was, that French Revolution was exactly that idea. And this was Hindenburg standing up going, this is not going to work out, we just replace King with even probably worse King. No, this is our work, we chose them, it's democracy, and it's awesome. It's like, no, you've still got the same power structure. So, if we take nothing else away from this, it's the idea that the spontaneous order is the centerpiece, the possibility that a society can self-organize, and it'll self-organize around these voluntary associations of people coming together. This is why contract law and rule of law are such a central part of the classical liberal libertarian position. Anarchism really means that we can make the law together. That's what it means. It doesn't mean that we just, no one makes bets. It means that we can agree on a set of laws and this will be self-governing. Okay? So this is the big idea. Alright, so there it is. Well, my argument here is that classical liberalism and libertarianism is not about you as an individual. We often sell it that way. We often present the virtue of it as, this is about freedom for me and freedom for you. I'm suggesting is that those are mechanisms of a broader point. And the broader point is that classical liberalism and libertarianism are a vision of how society can work. And this vision contrasts with other visions of how society works. And other visions essentially say, no order without an ordering force, leadership. In that language, there's a view with the sort of evolutionary bent, we'll perhaps appreciate what that means. This was also the foundation of evolutionary theory, was the idea that order in nature could emerge without the designer. And it's the same origin, but evolutionary theory, this idea of spontaneous order, evolution, didn't originate in biology, it originated in Scottish moral philosophy. It was Adam Smith that came up with that idea of spontaneous order. Darwin, 100 years later, copied that idea. And in nature as well. Right? This is the thread that runs through all of this. I came to this in modern complexity theory. Complexity economics is basically the same idea again. So this is the foundation. So Adam Smith's Invisible Hands, that's what that was about. And that's the reason we read Adam Smith and go, there it is, economics, it's about the market. No, not, it really isn't. It's about society, organized through a market. What a market does is enable that spontaneous order to work. We've seen this with the Austrian School of Economics, made this the centerpiece of their arguments. The reason markets is because what we're talking about here is as a self-ordering principle for society. Hayek went so far as to make up a new word for this. It's a few words that we wear. But that's what catalexy means. That's why that word's there. It's a statement about an ordering principle. Order brought about by the mutual adjustment of many individual economies, many individual deciding this, you do that, whatever. It's that mutual adjustment. In evolution, this is called adaptation. In economics, it's called adjustment. Good enough. It's the same idea. The mutual, decentralized adjustment to local circumstances is how we get work. And if we have that, if we have institutions and mechanisms to achieve that, we don't need kings. We don't need great leaders. We don't need enormous plans. We don't need that other way of ordering and organizing society. We can just set the rules and then just step back. That is the fundamental principle. And the big idea is that this works better.
How does classical liberalism propose to deal with the failures of the market if the society decides they want something which is harmful for society as a whole? What do? Are they against anything or...?
So there's two points you made there. One was failures of markets, so I'm not focused on that. Most of you have done economics, at least first and second, maybe even third year, will have come across this idea of market failure, that the markets sometimes market outcomes aren't necessarily what society wants. Maybe we want less pollution, and look, this market produces this much pollution. The classical liberal answer to this is contained in the work of a guy called Ron Coase. How many people know Ron Coase? What the answer here is that it's not a failure of the market, it's a failure of just the insufficiently allocated property rights. That it's not actually the market that was the problem, it's that we haven't actually got the market in those things. So missing markets rather than failing markets. So that's the first part. The second part was again, civil societies. Want it. That's your group. We want it. It's our group. We just need the right to have a break thing. It isn't a program.
What about, say, issues of hard drugs?
I like to say hard drugs.
I'll get to that later.
Yeah, don't be speaking about that.
All right. I want this to be the thing, because what we're trying to do, and I'm going to talk tomorrow, we're going to be presenting transport, we're sitting right behind you, on this point of how we actually form voluntary nations, voluntary societies around this thing. But the answer in every single case, I'm going to present as a generic answer, is just the problem with a lot of things, is that we end up having to make a single choice for everyone. So we end up having to compromise. If you don't like it, it's up to you. We all have to make the same choice. The whole virtue, the virtue of a civil society, voluntary society approach, is that we're trying to have groups. So if hard drugs are your thing, then you form a little society that makes that your thing, and you isolate yourself from everyone else. It's not, it just becomes a thing, that's what this group does. And so the mechanism here is emergent societies, emergent groups, rather than coercion of, we pick a rule and then we all have to obey the same rule. This is the way in which this is meant to work. So this will be a theme that we'll come back to again and again. So the freedom, I think, is not actually the foundation. I think it's spontaneous order or emergent order. Spontaneous order is the word that the population, people like to use. Emergence is the word that complexity people like to use. It's kind of refers to the same thing. What I want to talk through next time is just to say, to go back to one of the most famous bit of work in modern economics, and just show exactly why this is completely consistent with this idea. Hayek's 1945 User Knowledge and Society article, it's probably one of the most genius pieces of economics in the 20th century. Pretty much what the Nobel Prize for. If there's one bit of economics, you have to learn for that. And this idea is just the literal expression of market as spontaneous order. Alright, so what do we got? So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to say, that's my big idea. Just to say that what we're really talking about here is the fundamental, just bedrock of classical liberalism / libertarianism is not freedom, it's spontaneous order. Spontaneous order is about voluntary associations and groups forming. Right? The reason that we make that shift is that shifts us from the reason that we like it, or that it's virtues and values as individuals, to what type of society are we for. And the freedom thing gets this idea, it's a perfectly coherent individual argument, it's a little bit loose when it comes to as a, we want a free society. Why not? Whereas the notion of spontaneous order is the reason that we want this as a vision of what a classical liberal society looks like. Right? Now, the virtues that sit underneath this nowadays, this type of society is decentralized. That was the original point. The problem with the sort of king's vision is that you have one person deciding for everyone else. In modern economics, that's called a social welfare function. But what we're really going up against, or what we're trying to introduce, the virtue of this type of society, how we recognize this type of society, is that it is decentralized. There's lots of decision-making points, thousands, hundreds, millions, but they're all spread around. Now, the reason why that is good, so what's the value of that? The reason that that is good is that information and knowledge is also spread around. That's the key part that we see. So if you run back through those names that I mentioned before, particularly people like David Hume, they're all philosophers of knowledge. The fundamental question is, what type of knowledge exists in this society? Who knows what? So we end up with this notion of distributed knowledge, distributed information. The argument for why do we have free markets? Well, answer, free markets are really good at dealing with distributed information. That's what they're good at. Are they fair? Are they efficient? But are they good at dealing with distributed information and knowledge? Yes. Awesome, they're the best. We also have this notion of adaptation. This is a word from biology. But what it means is that each individual just looks around them and goes, a little bit to the left for me, a little bit less of that. They're just reacting to local signals, and they adjust themselves a bit. And lots of decentralized mutual adaptation, just lots of things are shifting based on what they see around them, is how you get order. That's where order comes from, that decentralized adaptation. Not from messages coming from the center, you must do that. That produces coordination. Right? That's the miracle of the market, is that but that works. And it sounds like it shouldn't work. It sounds like surely if we had some good engineers, we can design a better system, more efficiently get to what we need to do. Nope, that's precisely what we're trying to avoid. The virtue, the value, the of a market, of a distributed system is precisely that it coordinates itself into distributed, decentralized, adaptive way. We see it in biology, we see it in communication systems, and that's pretty much the internet is that mechanism. It also works for societies. The other thing that we get with this is we get discovery. We get the idea that we're not even sure what we want. Yes, and this system will find interesting new ideas will emerge here that they can spread through systems. We get price discovery, that's the Austrian idea that we're not really sure what something is worth, we experiment, we find that, put that, see if it works. As opposed to, that is worth this much, data theory value type of. So we get price discovery, we get entrepreneurial opportunity discovery. This is what ideas are stupid, crazy, what ideas are awesome. No one knows, you just put them out there, you see. So the whole logic of what we're dealing with here, of a distributed system, is that we don't necessarily start by assuming that someone knows what the correct prices are, what the proper technologies are, what the correct things we should all be doing are. We start with the opposite assumption, which is ignorance. No one knows. But let's figure it out. So you try that, we'll see. That's the virtue of this type of society, is that it'll slowly get to where to places that have that. What are markets? Markets are just mechanisms for doing this. We value markets because they're coordination mechanisms that enable us to do that. That's it. And they're of the good market, bad market in proportion to their ability to process decentralized information. Right. We're only going to take you if we've got time for this. The best metaphor for what a market is that a market is basically a communication mechanism. It enables thousands of millions and tens of millions of distributed people who don't know each other to nevertheless communicate with each other through prices. Just a little bit that way, that causes a ripple effect as prices up here and down there, adjustment, right? Mutual adjustment through decentralized information. Technical idea, but this is the foundation of the classical economy. Alright, so in one sentence, not individuals, freedom, end of story. This is a society organized on principles of spontaneous order, mutual decentralized adjustment, works better than one that isn't. That's the claim. This is an empirical claim. We can look at history and try and test this, we can go back to first principles and try and reason through it, but that's the claim. It's a claim about society. Now, if we are right about that, then we need individual freedom. Individual freedom is one of the mechanisms that we need for this. But individual freedom isn't actually the moral foundation. It's one of the ways in which we achieve this. We need freedom of speech, we need rule of law, there's a whole bunch of things we need for this to work. It doesn't just happen. But that's the fundamental claim. Now, I want to sort of present that as that's after many years of meeting with that, that's kind of where I've arrived at. I've noticed that a lot of other classical liberals have also arrived at more or less the same point. I want to suggest that it's not usually the door that most people go through first. Usually the first door is freedom. You value this because freedom, and then you go, okay, end of story. Any thoughts on that?
This strikes me as similar to the dichotomy between the rights-based and outcomes-based idea, that spontaneous order is outcomes-based. It's almost like the utilitarian argument, whereas the freedom or deontological rights-based.
And I guess that's one part of just unpacking. I'm not claiming that, and this is now the new law. I'm just, this is an interpretation that I've found very useful, is to actually recognize that the freedom and the rights-based arguments, they're absolutely unassailable as moral foundations. That's it. I argue against that as a moral foundation. But in terms of just why we care, explaining this to other, why we're fighting with other people who we're claiming are wrong, I don't think the freedom argument is the one to bring. I think it's actually what we're ultimately arguing about is the type of societies that are best for human beings to live in. And it turns out, somewhat counterintuitively, the types of societies that human beings flourish in are actually ones that are a little bit messy, that have this sort of no one in control aspect to it, that look like they could be improved. So if we have some leadership, we can fix up this messiness, right? They look like they're fixable. But the whole point, this was Edmund Burke, laid this down very clearly in the first instance. You said, okay, well, markets, they're messy and they crash and they bubble and they're unfair and blah, blah, blah. I said, yes, that's all true. Not denying that. But, the reason we can't improve it, the reason that's as good as it gets, is that they've got these other properties. And this other property is a bit hard to see at first. It's the order that they produce, the spontaneous order. You say, well, that's surely that came from the government. Surely that was there already. Surely the market didn't do that. No, they did. It's hard to see at first because it's, when they're working well, that's what happens. You just get a coordinated output. They are very, very good at dealing with continuous flows of new ideas. They're very good at dealing with conflicting information. That they can figure that out. Not by you'll have a try, just through mutual adaptation. So that's kind of the theme I want to really sort of present here is that a lot of this discussion you have about property rights and value evaluation, markets, value evaluation, and so on, are that these are the instrumental mechanisms that we need in order to generate the type of society that we want. The type of society is, I think, the classical liberal slash libertarian position describes really well. But it's one that produces a spontaneous order that makes effective use of distributed knowledge and information. And that's valuable. Societies that have been able to develop these sorts of institutions have generally outcompeted societies that haven't. Whether it's by people choosing to leave the other ones and join these ones, whether it's by when they run into each other, this one wins. Just everything that we know about military planning and organization theory and so on suggests, and engineering suggests, that it should be the other way around. The more ordered, controlled, centralized one should win every time. It doesn't. It really doesn't. But the reason here is just that those ones are really good with given information. Fixed, if this is the set of things and we can organize, people have the same ideas, they will win. Not otherwise. All right. So that's kind of the thing I want to do for the first part of this. I think the argument for why classical liberalism is that it produces effective human societies that humans can live in, and humans can flourish. And the reason that they flourish, these types of societies, is that they enable new ideas to come from within. New ideas can be developed and adapted. They're flexible. They have all of these dynamic properties. That at any one point in time, you might look and go, oh, that's messy, or that's structured, or that's who's in control. You always make those arguments. But the argument is that these societies are ultimately better than centrally controlled societies. Using the word societies over and over again. Now, to generate these types of societies, we need freedom. But freedom is a means to an end, in a sense. All right. any thoughts on that before I move on to just explain the economic argument? Just repeat this in economic language.
Just like with all that sort of stuff, how government sort of interferes with it, but still lets it go on enough that they can actually make money off it, like tax farm sort of thing.
Yeah. So what you end up with here is, I think this is a story about why a minimal government, you need some kind of rule-making organization or rule-enforcing organization. Right? We can put our minarchist, I mean, our anarchist hats on and go, all right, we can have this fully privately provided, I guess. We can put our minarchist hats on and sort of suggest, well, maybe that's a collective action problem that we all contribute to, we can do that. But we're sort of starting to see that there's a role for something to provide the initial rules that we need. That needs to be provided. But beyond that, we can immediately start to see the costs of government getting out of control, or getting too big, or we're competing with these notions. So, let me go through just the basic economic model here. So, some of you would have seen this before. This is just, I think, if there's one bit of economics that describes how this works, we can say Adam Smith, visible hand, and so on and so on. The modern version of it is this article here. How many of you have actually read it? I'm assuming quite a few. We're going to go through and do a little hagiography and worships from the end. Again, if you haven't done any economics and you're only going to do 20 minutes of economics, this is the 20 minutes of economics that you need to do. It's 21 pages long. It really is, it's all English slides. There's no maths in it at all. You can read it as human beings. It's available on webs. All the action happens in the first 3 pages. It's you've really got no excuse not to read it for 2 minutes. So, this is F.A. Hayek writing in 1945 at the London School of Economics. He was a sort of 45-year-old professor of economics who was fighting with the socialists, and this is the end of the Second World War, fighting with the socialists at the time, who were in the ascendant, who were the mainstream paradigm. He was the crazy person out on the wings, sort of going with, he was the Edinburgh doing this. And this was Hayek, lone voice in the wilderness, against the thousands and thousands of sensible, rational economists going, look, we won that war, that's awesome. All right, communism defeated, totalitarianism. But during the war, this is sort of Second World War, during the war, what also happened was that the economies were more or less taken over by government. There was a lot of wartime planning, so prices were planned, industrial planning. You had more or less what was being said is, okay, so we won, so we're not communists, we're a market society, but that planning was awesome. Like, look what it did, we did the win. So the dominant idea at the time, in terms of how do we organize the society economically, was essentially called market socialism. Anyone more or less know what that is?
What's that?
As compared to, say, communism.
Like quotas and that sort of stuff in certain sectors, heavily regulated, but most...
Yeah, it was actually a little bit further on than that. It was just saying that, look, we're going to have markets, so markets have prices, so we're going to have prices. So it'll look like a market economy, but we'll figure out, just leave the prices to us to figure out. Right? So we've got smart economists with their maths and stuff who'll figure out what the prices should be. That's scientific socialism. Scientific part was the economists to do the figuring out what the prices should be, and the socialism, it was in that film. Now, see where this is going, right? Hayek's defending markets, saying, guys, you've really not understood what markets are, if that's what you think they are. So, this was Hayek arguing back against scientific socialism. Everyone was convinced that scientific socialism, as in, we'll have markets, free markets, but we'll decide the prices. Well, it's going to work, because it worked through the war, wartime planning, it really did kind of work then, because they knew what they were trying to achieve. We need this much done there for that, and we need tanks there, and we need that, and these people have to eat this much bread and stuff. So it was, you could plan as to, well, therefore that's the price of bread, and that's the price of tanks. So the idea was that all of the smartest economists in the world getting together going, yep, scientific market socialism, this will work. Markets, economists doing the figuring out, awesome, this economic science. Hayek was like, except for the fact that it's not going to work. Why is this not going to work? Said, because, what about new knowledge? Like, what? Well, I don't know, I haven't yet. when it does happen, how's this going to happen? That's mine. So it turned out Hayek was exactly right. We know this now. But I want to look at why he was right. So Hayek's point was that this scientific socialism, this idea of planned markets, was fundamentally flawed because it couldn't cope with distributed knowledge or new knowledge. That was his argument. So look, it's not going to work. It's going to all fall over badly. It's going to be embarrassing for everyone because it's not going to cope with that. So what he essentially asks people to do is, well, this scientific socialism idea you've got, what it really is it's kind of like saying you've got this really smart king who knows what everyone wants and can calculate what the prices should be and impose those prices. The scientific socialism is a centralized idea that someone knows what has all the information. Right? Well, yeah, well, of course it's the economists. They have all the information. Right? Say, well, no, it doesn't work like that. What his point was, and the point of this paper, and the thing that makes you an Austrian economist, and the thing that sort of once you grasp this point, this, a lot of standard economics just looks wrong from there on out, is to think about the nature of knowledge in a society. The title of the paper, Use of Knowledge in Society. Right, that's what this is about. And Hayek's point was to say, well, look, this, when you think about the type of knowledge that exists in an economy, the type of knowledge that society has, the fundamental thing we can say about it, this was also the point that David Hume made, which was the beginning of his inductive philosophy, this was the point Adam Smith made about open factories and so on, was that this knowledge is specialized and distributed. I know a lot about, let's say, right? Someone else might know a lot about bees. Other people will know about specialized knowledge on other things. The economic problem is how we coordinate all that distributed knowledge. Without me, who knows a lot about bears but nothing about bees, without me having to sort of acquire all that knowledge myself. Right? So this is it sounds strange to put it that way. If you haven't seen this before, it sounds weird. But this is the economic problem. It's how can we have a society where each of us knows a lot about a little bit. I'm specializing in this, you specialize in that. Which means that most of us are ignorant about most things. Most of us know just nothing about bees or nothing about bears. It doesn't matter as long as someone knows. Right? And the economic problem of a society is how to coordinate that knowledge so that it all fits together. So that we get bees, whatever bees do, honey, I guess, in pollination, bears do, you know, rides, I guess. But that knowledge is coordinate. So that's why for economists, for Austrian evolution, I mean, for Austrian and classical liberal economists, the key word for us is coordination. Coordination of distributed knowledge. That's what we're trying to understand. What do markets do? Markets do that. They don't allocate resources. They don't really care about that problem at all. They coordinate knowledge. Now, the mechanism for that then is the price system. So we say that's why we value the price system, is that it's a mechanism for communicating all of these mutual little adjustments about specialized knowledge where I never have to know about bears or bees or I never have to know what you know. All I have to know is just how you're traveling with that, whether I need to change what I'm doing. So Hayek made a bit of a story about what the paper really does. So look, there's two types of knowledge in society. The scientific and technical knowledge, the sort of stuff that engineers know and can write down, a specialized agency could potentially have. And his point wasn't that when the scientists and socialists were thinking about knowledge, that's what they had in mind. They were all engineers, that's pretty much what they had in mind. Okay, and then there's this other sort of knowledge. There's knowledge of time and place. And what he meant by that was just the knowledge of kind of just knowing that, well, that person is probably going to need lunch there, and that person's tires are worn out, or there's an opportunity there. Just sort of knowledge of entrepreneurs, local knowledge. Now, my next point was that this first part, maybe we can centralize that. Maybe we can put it all in a big file and have a really smart process that just knows it all. But that second type, impossible. Absolutely, fundamentally, there's no way that that can be known by someone. And that was his argument. That was the knockdown argument, saying, once you accept that, this type of knowledge exists, it's distributed, it cannot be known by a single mind. That's it. There's no such thing as scientific socialism. It's only mind coordination. that's kind of the point of the paper. And we end up sort of arguing, and therefore this is why a market society is that what a market system is it's a distributed communication mechanism working through prices that enables that vast coordination of that distributed knowledge of time and place that cannot be known to one mind. But that's as good as it gets. His point is it's amazing that it works. It produces in order. We have a market society to enable that to happen. So I'll just finish by throwing up some quotes on this. The point here is this is Hayek's argument, this is the sort of foundation of classical liberal economics, is that we value a market society precisely because what we're dealing with here is an efficient communication mechanism. This is quotes from the article. Let's look at the price system. It's a mechanism for communicating information. That's what it is. It's distributed communicating information bit of infrastructure. And its real purpose is not to be efficient, it's not to be just, it's not to be fair, it's not to be non-worldly, it's not to be none of those reasons. Its entire value is the communication mechanism. And what it enables to happen is it enables individuals to coordinate with other individuals into an economic society that somehow fits together. Spontaneous order, emergent order. That's it. That's the why market society, that's why a free society, a classical liberal society, is by definition a market society. It has to be. Can't be anything other than that. So I'll just throw this one at you as well. Hayek was banging his head against walls trying to get people to understand this. And you know, this is a nice point. So look, if someone had invented this, they would be the most famous inventor in the history of the world. They've invented a mechanism that enabled billions of people to coordinate with this unbelievable efficiency. Like, that's better than inventing pretty much everything else. But we don't even see it, because no one actually invented it. We just kind of stumbled upon this mechanism. Which is why it's precious, which is why it needs to be defended, which is why it's not, which is why the starting point is that it doesn't exist. That we need to spend a bit of time and recognize that it's there. Okay. Long German sentences, but I just want to emphasize that the point here is that when Hayek, at his finest, is no economic prize winning finest, trying to explain what is this thing that economics is all about, a distributed information coordinating mechanism. That's what economics is the study of. No point for that to say the word efficiency, or allocation, or scarcity, or resources. Any kind of definition of the economic problem. Coordination of distributed knowledge. Markets can do that, pretty much nothing else can. We can do it on a small scale, that's a fact, but at a large scale, we need this. Alright, so you finished there. So I started with this first point that, you know, classical liberalism, what's it really about? Answer, free society, the coordination basically free society. The ability for people to form voluntary groups, come together, achieve the ends that they see. Why is that an economic story as well? Well, we need markets to do that because that's kind of the only thing that works to coordinate distributed knowledge. It'd be great if someone could come up with something else, but this one works. It works through price mechanism, it works by rule of law, it requires property rights. There's a bunch of things it requires. That's why we value those things. But what we're really after here understanding the value of a distributed coordination mechanism, and recognizing that just as a society ruled by dictatorial kings is bad, so is one ruled by dictatorial economists for the same reason. They're both dynamic disasters. Alright, so what does it mean? We value classical liberalism not just because freedom is a moral virtue that sits well on the individual. It's because classical liberalism describes the type of societies in which human beings flourish. And those societies are basically evolving. They can change from within, they adapt, they don't tear apart, they don't tend to have periodic revolutions, they just adapt to changes. They're dynamic. But at any one point in time, they'll look wrong. They'll look like, oh, we can fix that. They'll look messy. So that's kind of my summary of what classical liberalism/libertarianism is and its connection to economics. Those things are very closely related. What we're really describing here are dynamic